Yeah, my name is Katharina Stapelmann. I joined NC State last year as assistant professor, and I'm working on plasma for life sciences, what you can see here. I like it. It's a corona discharge, actually. And yeah, so I'm working on atmospheric pressure plasmas solely. So Dr. Shannon just showed some applications that were low pressure plasma, a little bit bigger. Plasma in bag is atmospheric pressure, I think. Yeah, I'm solely working with low pressure plasmas. The reason is with atmospheric pressure plasmas. The reason is because I want to treat humans. You can't do that in vacuum. I mean, you can, but only once. And the areas of application I'm doing the research for, life science applications. There are so many topics you can cover with plasma for life science applications. For example, plasma cancer treatments. This is really right at the beginning of research. We have some workshops already on the topic, and in 2020 the next one will be organized in Raleigh here at NC State. So this is really a strongly growing field with a lot of promising results, but still at a very early stage. Wound healing is one of the topics. There are some clinical trials in Germany mostly. The United States, it's kind of stuck at the FDA right now, but I think the United States are getting there soon as well to get the first, yeah, plasma devices really on the market for wound healing. You can also treat various skin diseases. You can treat wastewater. There's plasma agriculture as one of the topics. And those are the topics I'm dealing with, I'm doing research on. But also, just to give you an overview, what's possible, what is within this range, plasma for life science application. There's also plasma sterilization, plasma dentistry. I imagine you go to the dentist and he's not using a drill but a plasma. Painless? Ah, that would be great. Air purification is one big topic, especially for industries. And you can do various coatings, barrier coatings, functional coatings. For example, the PET bottles where you get some bubble water or Coke, they're usually coated with a very, very thin glass layer, because otherwise it would just lose the bubbles pretty fast. So they coat the plastic with a very thin layer of glass to enhance or prolong the shelf life of the product, and you still have the benefits of using a plastic bottle. Those are some of the applications, and the current projects I'm working on here at NC State is the CostJet, this one. It's a reference plasma jet that was developed by a group in Germany and is used, I think, at 5 or 6 different places all over the world now. Everyone has different expertise. Everyone has different diagnostic techniques. So the idea of this CostJet is to have one source at different locations to gain just a better understanding of the plasma physics and what's going on, the plasma chemistry. So everyone has his own diagnostic devices and his own ideas. So we are collecting a lot of data with this jet. I'm trying to understand the plasma chemistry. So what is produced and how does it interact with liquids and with biological samples and with biological samples covered with liquids? So there are a lot of complex systems. Plasma is a complex system consisting of different molecules and atoms and charged particles, and the radiation of a plasma plays a role, and then you have the liquid where you can produce some species, and then this whole thing is interacting with biological samples, or for example with skin, which is again complex, so a lot of complex systems interacting with each other. The next project I'm starting to work on now is the DBD for wound healing or for cancer treatment. The DBD is, yeah, the plan is there, the parts are there, but needs to be built. My idea is to have a voltage supply that is as flexible as possible. I want to adjust everything, the amplitude, the pulse rise time, the pulse duration, the polarity, just everything. And I want to investigate how does the amplitude and the polarity and all this stuff influence the plasma chemistry. And is there a way to tune by adjusting the voltage the discharge in a way that it just produces exactly what I want in the amount that I want, for example, for wound healing or for cancer treatment. You can imagine with one source doing both wound healing and cancer treatment. Wound healing, you want to have growth, you want to have cells that migrate and that proliferate. You don't want that with cancer. You want the cancer cells to die. So it's just a question of the dose. You need to get the right dose at the right time, the right amount to the patient, and then this decides if you have a cell growth, an enhanced cell growth, or if you can kill the cells. And the last slide for me is the water treatment for different applications. One application is the inactivation of bacteria and bacterial spores and biofilms in water pipes. Another application is the degradation of hormones, antibiotics, detergents, whatever is in our water system that we don't want to have in our drinking water. And plasma agriculture is the next application where you can produce fertilizer on demand by igniting the plasma just in the water that you want to use to irrigate the plants. For this topic, I'm collaborating with Dr. Bolotnov. Naveen is doing some very nice simulations and sent me these two pictures. This is one from the experiment, and this is a simulation picture. So I'm really glad that we have this almost same-looking pictures. So we're making good progress in this collaboration. And this is a picture of the experiment. Just let some gas flowing inside the liquid, get these gas bubbles, and want to ignite the plasma inside the gas bubbles or along the gas bubbles. And for that, of course, it's important to understand how do the bubbles form, how does the bubble shape influence the plasma, and that's what we are working on. Thank you.